Hi, this is Manjula Narayan, books editor, Hindustan Times, and I have with me Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni, who's the author of The Forest of Enchantments. That's the latest book, but she's the author of a great many books, Palace of Illusions, so many.
Mistress of Spices,
which, for the audience that doesn't read, I hope everybody reads. It was made into a movie with Aishwarya Rai in it, no? Yeah, so there. So let's just talk about this idea. I mean, like, the Forest of Enchantments is based on, is a retelling of the Ramayana from the point of view of Sita, right?
Yes.
So just talk about that.
Yes. So in the Palace of Illusions, I wanted to retell the Mahabharata story from Draupadi's viewpoint. And that was one kind of strong Indian womanhood. And then since then, I've been thinking about Sita, because I think she embodies another kind of strength. And so in Forest of Enchantments, she tells her own story.
You know, like, this is a constant, I mean, it's a constant obsession almost with us Indians. Like, through the generations, we've been, you know, giving versions of Sita's story, of Ravan's story, of, you know, the Ramayana from perspectives of different characters within it. So, I mean, and right off the top of my head, in the contemporary context, Devdutt Patnaik, I think, has, you know, dealt with it. Then Samhita Arni has done a little book. I mean, not a little book, but she's done a book. And Volga, I remember, the liberation of Sita. So, you know, how are you treating it differently? And is it possible to treat it differently apart from the language?
Yes, I certainly hope I'm treating it differently, because I'm taking Sita as a woman who was at once strong, but not always so. She's complex, she's many-sided, she loves Ram, she's upset with Ram, she loves her children, she's strong with Ravan, but when he is abducting her, she's greatly distressed. So I want to show Sita in all her different moods and sides, and the message I want to give Indian women is, it's okay to be yourself. You don't have to be perfect. That burden of perfection should not be placed upon you. Also, don't be led to think that Sita is meek and mild, because she isn't. She's an intelligent, strong, resilient character. And so that when people tell us, as they've been telling us for hundreds of years, be like Sita, this is the Sita I want our women to think about, and our girls particularly to think about.
Yes, people have been telling us for generations to be like Sita, but why do you think they haven't, like, you know, like, how in the contemporary context we are thinking of Sita as, you know, somebody who's struggling to manage things, and like a lot of Indian women, you know,
a single parent, yeah, bringing up her children all on her own. Yes. I think she's a great inspiration to many women who are doing that right now.
Yes. And also, you know, in the context of a woman within a marriage trying to hold her own with a dominant man and failing, you know, it's a familiar scenario for many people, whether they're Indian or not.
Right. And how Sita negotiates, how she gets Ram to agree with her. Big moment is when they go to the forest. Ram says, I'm going to the forest, but you have to stay home and take care of your in-laws. And Sita says, no, I really need to go to the forest with you. But she manages to put her arguments in such words that he agrees. Yeah. So right there, there's a really nice lesson for women, how to get people to agree with you.
Yes. So all these things make her a fascinating character. But now, to talk about, you know, the Mahabharata from Draupadi's point of view, which, you know, you did in the other novel. Now, the thing is that Draupadi, like, unlike Sita, nobody ever tells you to be like Draupadi. You know, and nobody wants to be like Draupadi, though you might think, oh, wow, great. But, you know, so talk about that.
Well, you know, I was interested in Draupadi and attracted to her character because of this opposite thing. Everyone's like, oh, you know, she caused the Mahabharata war. No, the Mahabharata war was caused by all these men. She was one factor. She said, you know, I will not just sit down and allow them to walk all over me, right? So she is strong in a whole other way. And my project there is a little different, where nobody before that said, be like Draupadi. I'm hoping that women who read this book say, oh, I have a lot to learn from Draupadi. I could be like her. I could be like her in this place, in this place, in this place. And again, Draupadi
except
is...
in the hair care.
Yes. We don't want the hair care. And that is another thing that I hope that readers will take away from, you know, my books, that they can pick and choose which aspects of the heroines really resonate within them, right? But with Draupadi also, I want to give that message that women should feel free to be themselves. There should not be this perfection icon that is passed down to us and weighs down upon us, right? We are fine just as we are.
I know how Indians would react to these stories and, you know, these retellings. But what would a reader who's an American, like, you know, a proper American who's not of any, you know, South Asian descent or has known these stories, how would they react? How do they react to it?
Well, I have been delighted. You know, Forest has just come out, so we'll have to see. But I've been delighted by how people have embraced Palace of Illusions. And I think the credit goes to the great Mahabharata story. It's just a fine story with great characters and amazing, what shall I say, amazing conflicts, amazing twists and turns of plot. And Draupadi herself is just so resonant and so vibrant that people have taken to her. A lot of colleges are studying that book. Okay? Because there's a lot of classes in epic and myth, and many of them are studying this book. And I'm delighted because, you know, now our epics and myths are becoming even more known. Not only that, the retellings with women at the center are becoming more known. And I think people resonate with the strong woman who's at the center of these novels.
So now this is a question I asked Namita Gokhale as well about her Radha book. You know, who next? I mean, she chose Radha because she read the Sita, edited the Sita book 10 years ago.
And that book was very wonderful. It was a great influence on me. It helped me look at a lot of research sources that she mentions.
Okay. So, like I asked her, you know, who next? Which character, you know, which character from a great Indian epic would interest you?
Yeah. So now I'm looking at women from the stories of the Puranas. We have a lot of Puranas. And those women are just amazing. They have some very amazing and unusual stories and situations in which they are put. But I'm not going to give it away because I don't want anyone else to take my idea.